Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE's coverage here in Las Vegas for AWS reInvent 2024. I'm your host, John Furrier, theCUBE. It's our 12th year covering reInvent. I remember 2013, our first was the actually second reInvent. I think reInvent 1 was kind of a beta. I don't think Andy wanted to say that on stage, but it was technically the second. But so much has happened. Just the expansion of cloud regions, the overall CapEx infrastructure spend now to support the next generation inflection point around Gen AI, and just the overall growth globally of technology has been a big story. We got the person here inside theCUBE, Kevin Miller, Vice President of Global Data Center for AWS. He handles all the expansion, all the work involved, and thinking about getting more power and capacity.
That's right.
Like nuclear reactors. Well, welcome to theCUBE. We're going to go nuclear in this section.
It sounds fun. Yeah, thanks for having me.
So thanks for coming on. So first of all, explain to the folks what your job is, because you have probably one of the coolest jobs and probably a tough job and from an organization standpoint, to figure out how to bring more capacity. It's come up in every conversation.
Yeah, absolutely.
David Brown and I talked about it at length. The chips are only as good as the power that can power them.
That's right. Well, chips need power, and we need data centers to run them to keep them secure and available. So that's my job. And so it actually is a really fun job. I have a great team, worldwide team. When you talk about our 34 regions around the world, you know, at the end of the day, the cloud is not ephemeral. It is a set of data centers that we have in these geographies and countries around the world. So my team owns everything from taking a bare piece of land to building data centers, putting all the equipment inside, all the electrical and the cooling equipment. And actually, a lot of that's our own designs. And then the control system that runs the data center, which is really important to run them efficiently and with high availability. So we own all of that. And then, of course, all the 24/7 operations. Each of our data centers has 24/7 staffing to make sure that they continue to run well. And so that's all part of my team's role.
Just quick question on that whole design side. Is it open source, or you guys proprietary knowledge for you guys? How do you guys look at these designs? Are you guys collaborating in an open ecosystem? We've seen success with Open Compute Project, for instance. What's the strategy around some of the design thinking?
Yeah, we have some engagements there, but for a lot of what we do, it's a pretty fundamentally different way we approach the data center, where instead of sort of working on discrete kind of highly featured components in data centers, similar to the way we build services, we actually look at simplifying and building smaller, you know, building blocks that we can scale up. And so it's a bit of a different approach. And so a lot of that is our own development. But we certainly you know, work with a broad ecosystem of partners around it.
Yeah, back when theCUBE had no real filter, we could just get anyone on, like James Hamilton, he would unveil all the secrets. He used to talk about blast radius as a core concept.
Yeah, absolutely.
And in context to that, it was like scale. At scale, things break a lot. I know you guys have done such great work over the years. We've covered it on SiliconANGLE and theCUBE around, you know, the way you guys did Nitro and the connectors, just the history has just been an ongoing progress. What are some of those blast radius conversations you guys have now around design? Because as you roll out at scale, it's not just a real estate play. I mean, this, you're designing a system.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
It's the space, it's the location. Does it have power? Is it near water and cooling? Does it have sun? I mean, all these things are now into consideration. What are some of the features to get those primitives right? Mm-hmm. Which is like the classic AWS flywheel.
Right, building the right primitives. Well, I mean, within the data center, that's exactly how we think about it. We think about building primitives. And in fact, this week we announced a number of new components in our data centers. And that's actually one of the key stories, is that we've reduced some of the blast radius by, you know, close to 90% and for some of our electrical systems. And so, you know, we're really focused on continuing to improve reliability as well as efficiency, both carbon and cost efficiency of all of our capacity. And so we're really proud to be talking about some of those innovations. They really help, at the end of the day, help our customers.
What was the news? What was the news that you guys announced here? Because I want to make sure to get that out there. What was the key news?
Well, there's a lot of innovation around liquid cooling, around other components in our data centers, to just to streamline, to improve availability, reducing blast radius, as well as really driving improvements in carbon efficiency. And you know, with some of our improvements, we're seeing at peak cooling times up to a 46% improvement in our cooling efficiency, just the power that's used for it. And a lot of that, we do some pretty cool modeling with computational fluid dynamics to really make sure we never have to overcool, because, you know, basically any kind of excess cooling is just waste. You're wasting energy. And so that's a big part of, just like we think about services, how do we really remove underutilization and really drive utilization up? The same philosophy applies to our data centers.
What's the core innovation in the data center right now, if you had to point to one thing?
I think a lot of it is around liquid cooling and bringing liquid straight to chips, because it's a much more efficient way of removing heat. And with, of course, with all the AI innovations, what's really important with AI for training in particular, we want training to be efficient. And for it to be efficient, you actually need to pack as many chips as you can into as small a physical space as you can, because that reduces latency. And the latency is what drives efficiency. So that's that's one of the biggest.
And we saw the ultra servers with Trainium 2 now available.
That's right.
That's powering.
Yeah, we have them visible here at the show. It's great.
Yeah, and we saw Peter DeSantis' keynote. That was like a 6 months worth of content to unpack. It was like a geek fest.
Yeah.
If you're at the hardware, that was like, pretty damn good. It was a good one. So let's get into that, like unpacking that whole future. What are some of the things that you're looking at to power some of these large LLMs? Because that's the number one thing, getting the cost down and the scale up. Price performance is a word. It's been around the industry, but we're seeing an era now where price performance is hitting kind of the scale where the next thing comes out, increases the performance, but lowers the price. But right. it's step functioning through.
Right. Well, and I think one of the biggest new measures that we really are focused on is performance per watt, right? I mean, because we want to be able to do the same amount of work with lower electrical usage. And so we're really seeing those benefits. When you look at our Graviton or our Trainium processors, we're really seeing some of those benefits play out. We're also doing the exact same in the data center as well. So when I talk about not overcooling, it's really how do we get that out? But you know, when we look at electricity more generally, we're very close partners with a lot of electric utilities and generators and grid operators. We spend a lot of time working through. And in fact, you know, in some parts of the world, I think we probably have better perspectives on, you know, grid capacity and transmission constraints than the grid operators in some places. But that's part of what we do to really partner and to make sure that, you know, we're doing the right things to deliver electricity for the data.
It's funny you mentioned the grid. I won't say they're like slow, but there's like a lot of operating technology we've seen in the IoT space, especially in manufacturing and these other kind of older operating technologies. They're not necessarily IP based. Grid is kind of a similar model where it's been around for a while. It's critical infrastructure.
Absolutely.
How do you look at grid modernization right now? Because you guys are bringing a lot to the table.
Yeah.
I want to get into grid modernization. We'll talk about some of the community impact. But for grid modernization, this giving back to the grid, but the grid can't accept it.
Well, and I think a lot of the opportunity in the grid is actually you take what we've done in the data center and then you scale it up to the scale of a grid, because one of the things we've really innovated with in the data center is the control system, which is and all the software, the industrial software, which, of course, when you're talking about industrial operations, you know, it's 99% is like way too low. You can't tolerate 99%. You need, you know, highly reliable systems, you know, 6 nines, 7 nines reliable systems. That's what you need in the grid. And so you take that utilities, the kind of industrial utility software that we run in data centers, and you apply that idea to the grids. And I think there's a lot of opportunity to be smart about where do we place new capacity, both where do we, taking power from the grid, but also putting power on the grid, and using industrial software to really manage that more efficiently. There's a lot of opportunity there.
You know, Kevin, for us old school guys, grid computing used to be a term in the 90s.
That's right.
And so when I think of grid, I think that's the ideal state, is to have just a modern set of resource versus now it's highly selective. Take us through your selection process, because it's not like you're rolling into these towns and says, hey, we're going to build a grid node here. Or ideally, maybe in the future, that could be there. But like a lot of times the resources may not be in an area.
Yeah, we spend a lot of time, and there's no one factor that kind of drives it, but we look at a number of factors. Obviously, we look at where's power available, where do we have land availability. We actually spend a lot of time working with the community. We understand the local workforce. In some communities, we find like recently had some large announcements in Mississippi, you know, $11 billion in Mississippi and in Indiana, the state of Indiana around South Bend.
Yeah.
And these are places where, you know, we've worked with the local communities, and we see a real hunger for that workforce development and a joint collaboration to make sure, whether it's through community colleges or other programs, that we're actually training a next generation workforce, while of course having land and power and the other conditions. You know, we need to understand what are all the constraints for us to build data centers and make sure we're operating within them.
I remember talking to Andy Jassy at one of the replay parties many, many years ago, maybe about a decade ago, around when Major League Baseball went from old stadiums with the AstroTurf to the kind of the pristine fields, kind of like the Fenway Park vibe.
Yeah.
They had new ballparks being built, and they would revitalize cities because they would essentially be a physical plant, a ballpark, and then around it, restaurants, just the economic throughput that came from that that facility was huge. Now, and we were riffing that, hey, you know, these regions are bringing a digital revitalization. So talk about how you guys are seeing that play out, because I see that being a big story. Because you go to Indiana and drop $11 billion, you're in Mississippi $10 billion. that's real money.
Oh yeah,
and there's absolutely a facility plant there. You got a, you know,
yeah,
a ballpark,
yeah,
the region.
Right. No, it's, I mean, it's a data center, and so obviously there's a number of ways that that shows up in the community, and we do some economic studies, and we look at, you know, the GDP benefit for that local economy usually is multiples of what of the direct investment, because the direct investment, of course, covers the construction and all the jobs that are created during the construction. There's jobs, you know, obviously to operate data centers, and all the workforce development that has to happen for that to take place. But then, you know, we also just partner closely, you know, with communities. Oftentimes, it's we build programs like Think Big Space, which is an idea where we go into a local school and build a space where, you know, bring in 3D printers and Lego kits and Technic kits and really see a ton of engagement with younger kids and really realize like, hey, I can solve these interesting science technology problems. And so it's really fun to see some of that open up. And some places it's literally planting trees and helping communities just, you know, do what they want to do in their community effectively.
And so get them exposed to the technology. Those next kids are going to be building the next power and cooling technology.
Absolutely.
You never know. Robotics clubs are popular in those areas.
Oh, they're
now
so popular. Yeah. I mean, some amazing things that they can do, you know, with robotics. So, you know, it really fostering that innovation and actually bringing that to communities that may not have that previously, where there's just not that genesis of whether it's your parents or employers or someone who wants to do that. You know, we can show up. I mean, my team, I spend a lot of time meeting with my teams in the communities, and frankly, they love spending that time within their community because it really shows.
So Kevin, I got to have to ask you the whole old way, new way around data center construction. The old way was, oh my God, we need to rack some servers. Oh, there's some real estate available. So real estate trust used to run all that business, and it's just a plant, and they just, okay, and then they plug power, and next thing you know, they're sucking all the power out. Mm-hmm. Not really scientific, and now it's a little bit more crafted.
Oh yeah.
Talk about the difference between the two, how the discipline's changed,
mm-hmm.
how the market's changing,
mm-hmm.
the personnel's changing.
Yeah.
Take us through the old way, new way. What's the transition look like?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think the big thing for us is, as I was saying, we build our own data centers, and we really rethought the way that works. I think traditionally, you know, you'd buy, for example, complicated, like, you know, UPS systems, and they have a lot of functionality within one system, where we've really taken it and pulled it apart, really simplified it. And then again, it's that industrial control software on top that actually is a lot of the magic in terms of, you know, we have a certain operation in our data centers. You know, a traditional data center, if you have a failure, you might have a long run book. You know, we do steps 1 through 84 to resolve it. And we had one of those procedures where, you know, to diagnose a certain failure would take us hours, right? And during which period, you know, we were running our generators, we had to have backups running, and we are now using industrial software to manage that, where instead of hours, literally the software takes 2 seconds. It can identify the problem and then change the configuration of our electrical system to fix that problem. And therefore we don't even have to run a generator. So that's the kind of benefit we see when you think holistically about the data center. You focus on simple components, and then that software, which has predictable, just like we build services, you know, having predictable failure recovery paths is so important, and it really leads to higher availability for customers, and obviously carbon benefits. Not having to run generators is a huge benefit.
I was talking to Dave Brown about Tranium 2, and we got to do a little throwback. Oh yeah, back in 2007, I was working on this, and like we were kind of going, but he's an OG on EC2, and you know all the history, S3 and whatnot. Yeah. You've been there.
Yeah.
But one thing he said that was striking, and I want to get your reaction to this for your world, because he said, quote, "We've gotten really good at building silicon, and the time it takes to tape out through the advancements of what Amazon brings to the table through those experiences, certainly with Annapurna," he went into great detail.
Yeah.
But the point was, is that, hey, we've gotten good at this.
Yeah, that's right.
How good have you guys gotten at data center building? What have you learned? And what does AWS and Amazon scale bring to the table?
Yeah.
Obviously, supply chain, knowledge.
That's a big part of it, yeah. And I think that I totally agree. We're very good at chips design. And I'd say in many parts of the data center, we're that way as well. When I think about our electrical systems especially, we've gotten very good at understanding, you know, what does it take to go from 1 mile an hour to 60 miles an hour, right? And when we're building a new component, we'll test it. But then the question is, okay, next year, can we get 100x of those? And obviously to do that, you have to be thinking way ahead in the supply chain and the components. And it also goes into the design, because if you can have simpler designs with more repeatable components that you can manufacture quickly, that reduces your time to deploy a data center and the reduces the variability you see from different supply constraints. And so, you know, we've gotten very good at building data centers. A lot of that is about how much can we manufacture. you know, offsite and sort of pre-manufacture and have that staged? And then how do you pull it all together as quickly as possible? Yeah. So it's been pretty cool to watch.
Yeah, it's awesome. And you know, you guys bring a lot to the table. I just will say as a side note here, I was just in Atlanta for Supercomputing 24.
Oh, yeah.
Liquid cooling was the hottest topic. I mean, who would have thought?
No pun intended.
It was hot.
Yeah. It's critical going forward, just given the density that we're seeing and the need to have as many chips as you can in a small space.
Are you guys doing direct cooling on the chip?
That's right.
Around the chips, around the system?
No, we're doing direct to chip cooling through like a liquid, a cold plate technology. I mean, we think that's, you know, there's a whole ecosystem. Of course, it depends a lot on the chips as well and the rest of the components, what they will accept. We think the direct-to-chip is where we are.
You can really see with heat coming and then cool them down, do some routing.
And the one thing that I think people don't quite understand with liquid cooling is some people think that that involves a lot of new water. It's actually, it's a closed-loop system. So the fluid is not not bringing fresh water in. It's actually a closed-loop system to, you know, take chilled water. And by chilled, it's not very cold, but it gets to the chips. It takes the heat away, and then that heat is exhausted. So we're actually really proud of how much water we don't use. We don't use a lot of water in our data centers, and this doesn't change that, actually.
Well, I think that brings up the whole point of it. It's not just, you're not assembling a bunch of servers, bespoke, and bolting them together. You guys are looking at it as a system architecture.
Really think about it holistically. Exactly. That's one, I think, one of the key innovations.
All right, so you got the energy thing you're working on. You're powering the LLMs. You got the grid modernization. You're designing your own data centers. You're learning a lot. You're getting good at it. You're serving the regions. All good stuff. Now, nuclear has been discussed.
I think we're going to go to nuclear at some point today.
Got to go nuclear here. Nuclear power. A lot of people, including myself, are not peaked on how safe it is, and there's a lot of documentation out there.
Yeah.
And then how that could actually be a driver.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about the strategy on nuclear. Is what's gone into it? What's the thinking?
Yeah.
Share your thoughts on this.
Well, I mean, a couple things to start with nuclear. First off, it's not going to be something overnight, and it's also something that obviously it has to be safe. It has to be something that is even safer than we have in prior generations. I think it's really interesting if you actually look at the U.S. Department of Energy website. There's a lot of good information that they've published about kind of the ideas and the possibilities, particularly with small modular reactors. There's a lot of focus on inherent safety and passively safe designs that don't require any action. You know, in the worst case, the system sort of shuts itself down. But, you know, we certainly look at nuclear energy as, you know, lower carbon than even wind or solar, right? Because wind and solar actually still have carbon in all of the mechanics, everything, you know, to build those sites. So it's actually lower carbon when you look at it. Obviously provides more of a firm power, 24/7 power source. And so, again, it's not overnight, but we really do think that down the road, it's going to be a really important enabling technology as we, Amazon, and we, the world at large, transition towards a carbon-free future. We think it's a pretty critical and important technology.
Yeah, so you guys are working on that. Okay, cool. So not a lot to report at this point other than you working on it.
But yeah, we've made some investments. We're partnering closely with an SMR manufacturer in X Energy, as well as with utility partners that are planning to then deploy those, because, you know, we plan for all of this to be grid connected. You know, our data centers are grid connected. We want to pull power off the grid. We're excited about new sources of energy on the grid.
Yeah, and that's really good. Where we need the grid to be safe and secure and efficient,
reliable,
all that good stuff.
Operate it.
All right, let's zoom out and go for the kind of the abstract thought exercise. You get good at building data centers, you're connected to the grid. Now we're in a distributed computing paradigm. Do you see a vision where all these cameras on light poles basically are being powered by a data center? You know, computer vision.
Oh, yeah.
I just start to get to local zones and I start getting to distributed infrastructure.
Yeah.
Do you see those designs and or those data centers connecting to extensions of the data center, like a power edge? You know, like this edge device that's basically data center in a box, I'm oversimplifying it, but how do you see that expansion? Because that would bring more goodness to the edge. Obviously, got the space thing going on, but like, just stay with the Earth for now.
Yeah, we'll see what happens in space. No, I think that's right. I think, I mean, first off, fundamentally, there's sort of laws of physics around, you know, when you look at like how rivers form. It's almost like how a river forms. Yeah. So, you know, where it's sort of the widest part of the river, I would say, is kind of the regions, the core infrastructure we have today. But then, you know, the river has to start as a stream somewhere. And so those streams can be, like you said, the individual cameras. And, you know, a lot of cameras today actually have a ton of compute power and processing on them. And that's not going away. I mean, I think there's still going to be a set of, you know, software that runs there that's actually helpful. But then the next level up might be, you know, we have 600 points of presence around the world today. It could be a point of presence or like a local zone that we have. And then eventually those sort of aggregate up into the widest part of the river, which is where the region is. So, you know, I think fundamentally you're still going to see something like that over time. It's not going to be one size fits all. It's going to be a progression.
We saw the cell tower expansion. Every town and city had to have one.
Oh, yeah.
Now they needed coverage, a little bit different dynamic, but I can envision.
Well, I think it's pretty similar, actually.
Yeah, local towns and cities will need, and they're going to be like, there's no playbook for them.
That's right. I mean, it remains to be seen what sort of, you know, what's that intermediate step? Because again, I think a lot of edge computing devices, whether it's a phone or a camera or any other device, is going to have a fair bit of capacity on it to begin with. And so then the question is, you know, where does the network, where do you need a lot of networking and where do you need actually some compute power? So we'll see.
Well, Kevin, great to have you on theCUBE. I love this topic. As you know, I love to geek out on the infrastructure.
Yeah, absolutely.
Final question for you. What's the coolest thing you guys have done that you can point to say that's the coolest thing we've done?
Well, I mean, I think that I am very proud of our work to reduce our water usage. And so you look at what we've done in regions like San Francisco or in Ireland, where, you know, between 85 and 90% less water than prior generations. That's a really important, you know, we're really focused on our goal to be water positive by 2030 and actually turn more water back to communities than are consumed for our operations. But we're already making some really good progress on that, and that's something I'm really proud of.
That's a game changer. That's earth-changing.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Thanks for coming on theCUBE. Really appreciate it.
No, thanks for having me, John. Yeah.
All right, getting all the action. Going nuclear here. We get the nuclear option coming soon on powering those chips. But the key to success with these chips is getting that power and energy, because the LLMs that are coming down are going to get smaller, faster, cheaper, price performance. Again, powering this next generation AI is AWS. I'm John Furrier here in theCUBE, Nuclear Reactor of Content. We'll be back after this short break.